you want to just come a little closer, yeah, and just kind of sit in a circle around me, it'll make it a little bit easier for me to talk. Yeah. We're here to talk about the festivals this summer. All zillion of you. So, the first festival of the summer I went to was Sunrise. Who went to Sunrise? Yeah, cool. Did you enjoy it? Yeah. What was special about it for you? Me. What else? You know what I need? I need someone to get one of those microphones and hand it to whoever's talking. Anybody up for that? Any volunteers would like to be the microphone person? It's a very important job. Okay, what was special about Sunrise Future?
What amazed me was it had all the good things about a big festival without all the bad things of a big festival, and then had all the good things of a small festival without the bad things of a small festival. It got it right. We'd come a long way from years ago. Years ago, I was a purist, Stone Age purist. Glastonbury was too commercial, didn't want to go to big festivals. Now, I can see a place for a big festival, but it has to be done right. And Sunrise, for the first time that I've been to a big festival, was done right. It just had the right ambience, not trying to reach too far. The love vibe was there. The love was there. It had a little bit of everything. Sorry, I'm not getting too specific, but it was just wonderful. I like the raw food cafe, too.
We got Scribe here. Writing down all the positives and all the negatives of each festival and, the challenge, not necessarily negatives, but just maybe what was missing that was there would make it more complete. Anybody else have to talk about Sunrise? Mr. Sunrise himself. So,
hi, how are you? So, I suppose Sunrise was, I think it was nice to hear that you got it right in many ways. I think we have created something that somehow is cutting edge yet green, is big but not too big, is small but not too small. But yeah, it's a bit challenging. Alright, well, I kind of initiated Sunrise somehow, finding it and coerced people to have their go and get it together. And, we perhaps should have done it only if we had corporate backing of some sort, because actually we gambled people's wages and livelihoods to put it on, and they've fallen short of the budget massively twice, which means we owe loads of people loads of money. Well, the event is fantastic. We haven't yet got to the point where the people coming are all prepared to pay to get in, but to give up the change to make it actually pay for itself. So that's made it incredibly difficult to keep going, and we're struggling to make the next one happen.
So do you have any regrets about this?
If I would have thought about how difficult it's been, and if I would have known the amount of financial burden I was put upon the community that I was trying to help get it together, then I wouldn't have done that.
I just want to ask you some numbers on that. I mean, how many? I know last year there were like 2,000 paid guests and 5,000 staff. But what
No, they weren't many. So the actual numbers are: first year we sold 2,400 tickets. We had about 3,000 crew. We lost £100,000.
And what about this year?
And The second year we sold 5,200 tickets, but the licensing authority, to get the license, cost an extra £200,000, and we spent £500,000 on the last Sunrise, and we only took £350,000, so we lost another £150,000. And we didn't have that money. We floated the whole thing on ticket sales, which didn't all come through, obviously.
Sorry, what, but the license was how much?
It's not just a license. In order to... one of the reasons for creating Sunrise was because there was a new licensing law that came in. And we knew we had to open up the opportunity. So we were the first ever 24 hours a day, 5 day long, 140 hours long festival ever to happen with a license. So we made sure that that gap was open for any festivals in the future. You know, anybody that follows us can do one if it's that long if they want to. But because the onus is now on festival producers to be completely responsible, all of the agencies, what's called the multi-agency meetings, are covering their arse. So basically, the police say, in order for us to feel safe, you need all of this security. And then the ambulance say, in order for us to feel safe, you need a field hospital. And the fire brigade say, you need a fire brigade. And then this say, you need a fence, you need this and that and the other. And so over three quarters of the cost of the festival goes on just the infrastructure, nothing to do with the content.
Would you say that's extraneous to needs?
Sorry?
Would you say that's more than we need?
Well, considering that we had one fight last year and it cost us £85,000 for security, I'd say that was quite an expensive... you know, that we're a peace-loving bunch of people. We're only forced down that road because of licensing issues.
How many tickets are you allowed? What's the maximum?
Well, we're in the license band of 10,000, which means we were allowed to sell 6,500 tickets last year, and obviously you sold 5,000. But there's a very strange thing. It's like they're, you know, the same thing's happening to the big green gathering. They were forced to have an extra £120,000 worth of security, and it forced them to lose £75,000 on this year's event, which means they're on the verge of bankruptcy. And the truth is that the family gathering, the company that puts on Sunrise, is in the same boat. You know, we're absolutely struggling to keep it. And it's not that... You know, and it's funny that the two greenest festivals in the country are on the verge of bankruptcy. Well, it's not funny, actually, but it's strange that the environment seems to be precariously balanced in a knife edge, and yet the solution is going down the path. I'm not sure what to do.
So what's the way forward in the situation that we're in?
Well, there is talk of... greener festivals starting to come together and make some kind of alliance to fight back. And we've recently talked to a guy called Chris Malcolmson, who's defected from the council side of the challenge. He's now working for Glastonbury Festival. And so hopefully he's going to join our team, if you like, and start to fight back when they say you need 10. We'll say, no, we don't need 5, you know. They say jump. You know, I do feel a bit like a performing poodle, you know, sometimes trying to get licenses. They just, you know, they've got no interest as to whether or not it makes a profit, so they just demand what they want and they force you to.
And what about the issue of people jumping over the fence and not paying to come in? How do you feel about that?
Well, it's if everybody that came to our festivals had paid, we wouldn't have any debts. Nothing. We'd probably be in profit. And so, being someone that creates events for grassroots alternative people, and then to find that that many of them say to me, I would never pay to go to a festival. And I think, well, that's great, we just lost £100,000, you know. And we haven't got it to lose, we're doing it. It's like the inspiration for our team to make Sunrise and the events that we do is the sense that we're a tribe of people that live in different places, and that we need these opportunities to come together and see each other. And So we pulled out all the stops with Sunrise. It's organic, it's sustainable, you know, we try to create as much content and stuff that anybody could ever want to have in the field. And yet, it hasn't inspired a lot of people to value it. You know, there's still this sense of try and get it for free if you can.
Who else here went to Sunrise this summer? You did. Anybody else? Yeah. You want to share some special moments? What was special about that festival?
It was brilliant, really. You know, even Mark Leavis says it's what Glastonbury should be like. So, you know, you've just got to get the numbers there and just get full up, you know, fill the place.
Sorry, doesn't stretch.
I wasn't actually at Sunrise, but I think it's a very interesting point about paying to get into festivals, because I can't afford to pay to get into festivals, and so I work at festivals, and I worked at four festivals this summer. I worked at Glastonbury, Glade, Secret Garden Party, and one more that I can't remember. But yeah, that's the key, and it's led me to think what I've always been interested in doing is to found a festival where everyone that comes is a contributor, and everyone that comes works in some way. Everyone does their bit. I know it'd be very hard to enforce, but that's sort of my dream.
The issue that we have is that the government is putting such a high demand on us for something that actually costs money, like security and stewarding. So just being there and participating is not enough. We actually have to participate financially also. It's kind of put on us to do that. I would love. I remember the festivals when no one ever charged anything.
Well,
you just showed up, you know. Yeah. You were at the Burning Man Festival, right? Yeah.
Oh, I will. Hi, I'm Samantha. It's interesting. I haven't been to many English festivals, but I've been to Burning Man quite a few times in Nevada. I'm sure some of you have heard about it. And it's interesting because everyone's so committed to paying at the door. There's no sneaking over any fences, but the pricing is so fantastic in that it's only £100 to go for 9 days, and once you're there, no money's allowed at all. So everything's on a bartering system, and it's really inspiring in that you just can give of yourself, and everyone's committed to like standing in a queue, you know, for like 10 hours to get their tickets, and everyone's so committed to being in that space and participating. There's no money allowed at all, and you know, everyone's just giving 100% of themselves. For me, it's one of the biggest festivals that kind of transcends just being a festival, in that you've got so much going on from art. Yeah, you can go check out the website for that. I mean, the art is just fantastic. But in terms of integrity around that, people are so committed to participating, what you just said, in terms of everyone's up there to participate, whether it's wearing a fancy dress or giving of themselves. They're not getting paid to give of themselves. They're just there giving of themselves. And it's amazing. It was like 60,000 people this year, all just giving of themselves. And the level of intention and community and tribal gathering is just, it's phenomenal. I think it's really where festivals are going to. And in terms of the country and the state of Nevada recognizing Burning Man as such a powerful community, because everyone's so committed.
Do you have security there?
They are. We have rangers, what they call, and they all kind of patrol the areas, and but not in terms of security like I know in some of the English festivals. It's quite gentle.
So the government doesn't demand that you have a certain level of security?
I think they have to. It, just in terms of, like, this year, the man, as you know, burnt early. So on Monday night, when you have this man up in the middle of the whole playa, you had some arse, like, guy who had been planning for 5 months to burn down the man. And because they had a whole green installation at the bottom, people could have been hurt. So the whole man burned halfway down. And, you know, in that way you need rangers and you need security, because he was locked up and taken off. And then the whole 60,000 people came together and they rebuilt the man in 3 days. It was just like, we've got to get him up. So, I think his side, in terms of what all the rumors that went around and figuring out what he wanted, it was almost to spice things up, to kind of create a little bit of a difference, because the man burns at 9 o'clock every year on Saturday. So I think it was creating a little bit of a twist. But the events there at Burning Man this year were all globally what's happening with climate change. I mean, the weather was, we had incredible dust storms that were just the worst I've ever seen. Rain, double rainbows, you know, lunar eclipse, full moon, dust that was about this thick just over everything. It was like the mud at all the festivals. So weather conditions were a bit more harsh than usual. But it kind of brings people together, you know, you're in this dust storm, you can't see for 5-6 hours, and you're all huddled together, so it's kind of like, I love that, it brings everything together. And
talking about mud, who went to Glastonbury this year? Yeah. Anybody want to talk about Glastonbury? Come on, Jones. Share a little bit about Glastonbury this year.
It's got to be one of the hardest Glastonbury's this year, because we're used to the rain and getting completely soaked and then drying out, and this year it just came every day, as you know, so.
Good.
Well, I want to say, though, it's about the lagging culture. I think it's a really difficult one, because seeing it at all the festivals, seeing it as a funny small world, you get people showing up, and it's a point of honour. I hear a lot of people say, I've never paid for a festival, so it's that badge of honour. And it's somehow how you crack that is really persuading people. It is our festival, and you know, we're making a contribution. Everybody is coming to make a contribution, and it is all power to you, man, for attempting it. But you know, you're obviously taking a couple of bars for that just to start with. And I can see Jeff wants to.
Well, we are kind of shooting ourselves in the foot, though, you know, because it's possible that both Sunrise and Family and the Big Green could go under because of that lagging culture. You know, so what a nightmare that would be, that this idea that something that costs a fortune can be got for free. Like, for every one person that gets in for free, you have to have two people that pay to make up the difference, because it costs loads of money just to, you know, there isn't much profit in these things. Because we focus so much on content, you know, and anybody that does a sustainable thing, it costs so much more, you know, just to lay it on. So we stick to our ethics, and we try and create the best thing. And you've just got to put it out there, you know, and I suppose it is possible that it will be successful in the end, but Sunrise is £65 for the first 1,000 tickets, and then £80. Four days, really. Like from Thursday lunchtime to Sunday morning, Monday morning. We can't lower the price because it costs about £65 a head if we sell out. And if we don't sell out, then we make a loss.
Maybe that we should sell the tickets earlier in the year, as soon as the last festival is finished, start selling the tickets for the next year, invest that money and hopefully make some extra change to cover the blaggers.
Yeah, well, what we've actually, the road we're going down is that we're trying to find ethical sponsorship companies that we believe in to put some money in, because we're quite a good way of promoting that stuff. And at the moment we're looking at setting up a CIC that deals with all the content, because actually what's happened is the people that have suffered have been the small people, all the musicians or the area coordinators.
Is there anybody here that didn't get paid at Sunrise?
Pony?
How do you feel about that? Can you come and talk about that? Come and talk about that.
Yeah.
I mean, I haven't, just as a point of note, in case anybody didn't know, I've worked for 3 years, and with all the expenses, I've actually paid to work full-time trying to get it together. And I've taken a lot of flack for the way that I've dealt with it, and, you know, and I kind of tried. I apologise in my heart, but I find it so difficult to keep moving forwards with it if I spend too much time worrying about the past, because I'm concerned that it won't happen again, so I'm trying to keep going. But anyway.
I don't really mind paying for the deposit, but I worked some hours and I think we deserve to be paid. Anyway, it was really worth it to go to Sunrise.
Even with the blaggers?
No.
Thank you.
I No, it's just a thought, but just in terms of Burning Man, people don't pay to go there, to festivals. It's people participate. So what if we started looking at some of the English festivals and people, they really, if we want to make festivals evolve and really about participation, then people want to go and not get something back. Like, we kind of live in a world where we have to get money back. Or if we just gave of ourselves selflessly and wholeheartedly, we could have a new way of running festivals where we're not selling things at festivals. You know, this idea of selling things at festivals is ridiculous. You go to Burning Man and people are giving. There's no get back, give, you know? So maybe we can shift this whole paradigm and start walking in. Well, I think lowering the prices of some of the festivals as well, you know, because then you're going to get more people can actually afford it. I mean, Burning Man, as I said before, is 100 quid for like 9 days. Some of these festivals in England are like £100 for 2 days. So. I won't answer that question anyway, so.
I'd like to follow on from what you were saying. There's a few events that have been party to over the last few years that have a very low entry fee, but basically everybody participates in making the events happen. Things like the Earth First Summer Gathering, Climate Camp. Now, they're not officially festivals, they're sort of eco-activist training camps, networking opportunities, but it's entertainment, and to all intents and purposes, it is like a real festival.
Only that is a festival.
Sorry. my name's Andy. I produce Festival Eye, a guide to festivals. Did everybody hear what I was just saying or something to say? the Earth System Gathering and Climate Camp, they have an advisory entry fee of about £15. There are kitchens set up, they have like little villages, and you affiliate to a village, help to prepare food, help with washing up. It costs about £2 or £3 a day for food. So if you haven't got very much money, you can go along, have a thoroughly enjoyable hands-on time for 5 days. The event usually makes a surplus, and everybody goes away happy. That's one model that seems to get through the licensing maze that definitely exists for all festival organisers today. If I can go on, I'd like to say the thing with the Licensing Act, as far as I've been able to pick up from people I've spoken to, is it's largely drafted for indoor events, so places like this have a different sort of risk to outdoor events. There are, you know, entry and egress issues and fire issues in an enclosed space, things that you don't get in an open space. And frightened, possibly inexperienced licensing officers who've got to cover their own back, misapply rules that were really written for indoor venues into an outdoor situation that can effectively price events out of existence. Some boroughs seem to be worse than others. There are some councils that take a very pragmatic view of the events they give licenses to. There are other areas where it's almost as if their remit is to stop the event if they can help it, or you've got to have very, very high hurdles to before you'll grant a license to the festival organisers. And this is something that should be challenged, and I believe there is a move to get the Licensing Act looked at again, so that it's, you know, there are clearly defined lines for what applies to an indoor venue and what applies to an outdoor venue. So that's basically what.
But just to stem on, like rainbow gatherings. Rainbow gatherings, you just arrive. There's not even a fee, and you cook. You know, you all participate. You know, you. I just rode my bike and arrived in the Yorkshire Dales, and it's just welcome home. There's no, can I see your money, please? And you just arrive and you participate. I was cooking food for like 400 people, you know. I know, that's the one I went to, yeah. Okay. Why would...
Pony, sorry. I think we have to stay small. It's as simple as that. I don't know how we get together big. I don't know.
Sorry, what did you say?
I think we stay small.
Modular.
The small model works. We pitch our festival somewhere halfway between the full. I'm a punter, I want my entertainment, and we're rainbow, there's no money. I think they're two extremes. I think they're just as hard to hold. I think we're all poor. I think on our circuit we're poor. I don't think we've got much money. I think most people, they can't go near a gate. They're not blaggers. They're shit at blagging, like me. I've got, 100 quid for cash rather than 110 quid full price. That's my blag. But they've got 30, 40 quid. They have. And I don't think we're blagged at our festival. I don't. I think 90% of people pay. I've heard of people going back to the gate because they arrive in the car and they're falling asleep. It's so reasonable what we're doing. It's so obvious what their money's for. At that level, you get more and more, you just do get more inclusion. People understand what's happening. We bring what you expect to find, but we're at the wood to fire the elementals for you. And we can deliver the elementals, and we can deliver the whatever's needed within entertainment. There's some issues at 10:30 Saturday night have got to deliver. We can include that. But we can't include everybody who plays a mute instrument around a fire. Somewhere, I don't know, they come from the crews, they come from... If we keep it small, we can handle it in our heads, we know what's going on, we can do it blindfold. We can keep it safe, we can keep it... And the license says 500 people, and it's a wedding license. You just ask permission, they go, yes, as long as you groom the land properly, and you get your website right, and you play it careful, you get a rubber stamp. And then you take the piss out of it.
There are different models, aren't there? Some people like...
This one works. This one holds and is sustainable. There are more people that want to come to these small events than are possible. When that overcapacity happens, another small one and another small one. They're waiting for us to get big and they flick us over every fucking time.
So sometimes
stay small.
Sometimes we like the big stage and we like the big crowds.
So what? I think the times are tough. And I think they're getting this every single time. The Big Green is nearly bankrupt. Sunrise nearly bankrupt. They're getting us on the Big Green. Fuck, our shields failed. Their fear model came right into us. The fringe was shut down by us, by our own security. £20,000 fine, £20,000 fine. They're frightening us. We can't run the two models. We run a love model. We exchange love. When that love's exchanged, we don't need money.
So you're saying abandon the big models? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know how we do them.
Why not all join together?
Maybe it should be a tropical rainforest. It is a car park. Maybe the moss does well at that point. Maybe strategically we put all our support into the big ones to see if we can make a plant grow and we water its soil. But we're too flippant with the big ones. We're far too flippant. And it's not abundant. When we're on this little plant, we're a micro bonnet. It feels like we're back in a tropical rainforest. And we're not. We're on a plant in a fucking car park. And small. But moss survives. Moss works. And when it's more people want to come to a small one, you do one. If you think you're
okay,
in theatre, you
okay,
do it.
Okay, this brother here would like to share something.
Hi, I'll just introduce myself. My name's Hagop, and I'm a DJ, music producer, musician, stage manager, and so on. But on a more constructive note, the thing that I've noticed after many years of going to festivals, you tend to have two sort of groups of people. You have the crew, who are working, who either got a free ticket to come in and work for a shift, or you got or working or getting paid for the whole weekend, depending on the job. Or you have punters who paid for a ticket or blagged their way in. And I think we sort of need to like have a festival where this sort of division is gone. It's almost like you have two races of people. And I often speak to people who are working. I speak to the security who are guarding the gates, who are, you know, who are supposed to be on duty, who are sober for the whole weekend. And they say, oh, you know, I'd love to be here. I'd love to party. And lots of them do. And I think that in a lot of these jobs, people put down a deposit in return for, like, as a guarantee they're going to work a shift, and then they get the deposit back afterwards. And it's not just stewards who will do this. I think security will do this too. I think police officers, firemen, ambulances, everyone likes a party. And I think it could be an idea that you have everyone working shifts. And I've done events as well where none of the crew get paid. But everyone does a shift, and people are responsible while they're on shift, and when they're not on shift, they're having fun. And I've seen it work. Not at, like, big outdoor festivals, but I've seen it work in indoor, like, 12-hour events that I've organised.
A couple of things, like, On that note, you've got a few problems if you have got a bigger event, because security, SIA approved security aren't allowed to offer their services on that kind of basis, and you're required to have that kind of security for bigger events. But I mean, Pony might say I was being naive saying this, but the DCMS in this country, who actually write the licensing law, have been asking theoretically on their website for feedback. And I mean, if everyone here was to bother writing and saying, look, this is your licensing is not actually working for these type of events, and actually try to share some of the knowledge. I mean, lots of people think that's maybe idealistic and naive of me, but I really believe that, you know, presented in the right way, like, let's try and make it what we want it to be. Do you know what I mean? Let's try and... I think at the moment it's true. I think to put on big events, I can't really see how you can merge the two worlds, because it becomes so bureaucratic. And it just crushes the creativity, it saps all the energy. And we somehow need to create a country where we don't have that much bureaucracy thrown at us every time you try and put on a big event. So I've just written a paper on licensing and how it's affecting community events, and I'm going to send it to the Department of Culture, Media and Sport, and if anyone else has got anything to say, let's just bombard them, do you know what I mean? So there's going to be someone sensible there. They're just human beings, do you mean? Don't get sucked into this them and us thing. Like, yeah, that's my point.
Time to fight back, right? Reclaim our party.
Hi, my name is Martin, and I work with Pony over a few festivals, and I'd like to share an experience. Festival, as we know, the Small World, this is small, it's a family gathering, and it was Saturday night, the music was pumping in every single tent. There was one arena and a few tents around, and they serve food, drinks, and the music, so it's all in one. We're sitting with a good friend of mine by the fire, and having a wonderful conversation, thank you. And suddenly, we realized that the music stopped in every single tent. Just stopped. And for about half an hour, maybe 40 minutes, there was this hum of organic, friendly, lovingly party. Just a hum, just the organic, people's energy. Got together in one center space and just enjoyed it as it was. What a pastime it was, guys. I'd like to say thank you to everybody who participated to it. Some people don't know about that it happened, but it did. And it was magical. So thank you very much. We don't have to... Well, it got me thinking, do we have to have a big stage? Really, do we have to have this pumping music that often confuses us?
But we like it, right? We like it.
Well, we do. Yeah. We do. I stayed after Glastonbury doing a bit of walking around. And it was tremendously painful. What people left behind in there. Whatever it was, the cause. It was rather painful to see all this shit left behind.
How do people in general feel about the big festivals versus the small festivals? Hands up, just a show of hands. Who prefers it? Who likes the big festivals? Yeah. I like them both, personally. I like the big ones and the small ones. Yeah.
If you can make a big one sustainable, but it's just, it's so much harder, and I think every time I've seen a big festival, my experience is quite limited, but that sense, like someone was earlier saying, losing the division between like a sense of a community of people getting together and creating something together, and then at bigger festivals much more, it tends to feel like something being put on, and I think it's hard to say. I mean, I know at Glastonbury, you know, there's an amazing sense of community behind the creativity that goes into it, but somewhere it's just so much harder to for communication on that scale between everyone.
And I have a Sunburn. I have a question for you. Why is Glastonbury making money? What is the key to Glastonbury making money? What's its success?
It's been 25 years of doing it in the same place.
What did you do right? Because other festivals tried and failed. Elaborate a bit.
Well, I mean, I live in Glastonbury town, and somehow Glastonbury, the place, has got this idea of being the last bastion of the ancient religion of this land, you know, the place where you can go and get some kind of sense of what was here before Christianity. And it inspires the whole chivalry thing with King Arthur and all that kind of stuff, you know. And it's set around solstice, which was traditionally when all the tribes came together. So it's kind of like the default Stonehenge gathering, but it's not around Stonehenge. It's a tribal place, you know. And it's captured the imagination of people somehow. He's just plugged away at it. He didn't stop. You know, 25 years later, if you keep doing it, in the end, like presumably, it does all turn out all right.
I think it's kind of lost its... I think it's lost that, though. It's become so commercial, and that's what makes money, because the media's there, and it introduces a different type of people that that want to go to it. But I think I don't go anymore, because I've been going since I was little, and for me it's changed. It's not a festival in the sense of, I don't know, it's just become mass, I don't know what the word. Yeah, I think it's a... No, but it then changes, do you know what I mean? I think it's important for festivals to get bigger in a sense, especially sustainable ones, because you introduce new people come that need to learn about things like that, and so it's important, but then there's a barrier when it becomes too big and it can't, I don't know.
As I understand, Glastonbury started off as quite a small festival. There were just a few hundred people who came to the first one. And it's gone through slow, steady, sustainable growth. And that's probably the model for any festival that wants to be big and have a soul. Anyone that wants to make a big festival happen, from the events that I've followed that have become big, things like the Big Chill. I went to one of the first Big Chills. There were only 500 people there. It was like, you know, a large garden party. Within a few years, it was many, many thousands of people, and it now rivals things like Glastonbury on its scale. Yet it still seems to have soul. I've missed the last two or three because it always clashes with the Big Green Gathering. I hope I won't be going there next year because the Big Green Gathering, can't go on. I very much hope that the Big Green Gathering can continue. But it seems to be a very good model to follow. I think organisers of events have to decide, do they want to keep their events to a certain size? A pony, small world event, as I understand, wants to keep it at the size it is, and there's no ambition to sort of make it a bigger thing, which brings, in a way, more problems. Licensing gets harder, there's more issues to contend with. I think there is something to be said for small festivals in that, you know, small is beautiful. Big can be beautiful too, but it's a much harder operation to get together. And I think slow, steady growth is the way to make a big festival happen. One last thing, these big organisations like Mean Fiddler are now Festival Nations, Festival Republic. They effectively buy a big festival, but anyone who goes there who also attends things like the Big Green Gathering and the events that really do have a heart and soul will notice the difference. I would say that things like Reading and Leeds aren't festivals, they're big outdoor concerts, big commercial affairs. Festivals are actually run by people for people. That's the real difference.
Just pick up on this, everyone seems to criticise.
Thanks. So can I just mention something? Daniel mentioned the Big Chill. What I do know about the Big Chill is they could easily get bigger. They very easily could be. The demand is there, but they refuse to do bigger festivals, and I think that's just worth mentioning.
Yeah, I think everyone's sort of quick to criticise Glastonbury, but if you think about it, it's a victim of its own success, really, because they've had to take these steps in the last few years to safeguard the future of that festival. And in this sort of world of endless red tape and politics that we now sort of live in, it's the only way they can sort of seem to keep that festival going. So there's always going to be people that say, oh, it's sold out, no, it's big sponsors, blah, blah, blah. But the harsh reality probably is that without all of that, the festival probably wouldn't be happening. And surely it's better to have it than not have it. If you look at the other end of the scale, like I think the most exciting festivals to go to at the moment are the small growers, the ones that are just getting going and you can see potential. And there's a real sort of magic in the air. That's the sort of festivals you're going to, because they're the best times when those festivals are growing and becoming what they are. And in years down the line, if it gets too corporate, then people just move on.
It really annoys me, everyone complains about Glastonbury being really commercial and all these, like, Sunrise or whatever, becoming commercial, and it's like, but there's all these people who are coming to a commercial festival. Like, people come to Glastonbury, they buy their ticket for 150 or however much it is, they've got like 500 quid in their pocket to spend, they're going out for a good time, like, that's their 4 days of their, like, 4 days of their paid holiday of their year, of like 2 weeks they get, you know. When they want to go to Glastonbury, they've got £500-£700 in their pocket to spend, you know. They want to go out, they want to be able to spend that money. And there's a lot of people in this community who earn their money at the festivals, you know, and they are commercial things. Like, Rainbow and commercial festivals are completely different things. People go to Rainbow and they expend energy on the gathering. People go to commercial festivals and they don't expend energy, like, putting them on. And if you've ever been involved in organising an event, then you'll know how much work there is that goes into it. But lots of, if you've been to Glastonbury, there's not people there volunteering to help. Like, do you know what I mean? They leave their tent, they leave absolutely everything. They don't want to help at all. They want to go there, get ruined, and spend loads of money and have a good time.
But this is the whole thing. It all boils down to money. This whole idea of money, 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 money at festivals. If we get to this point where people are actually there giving food because they want to give food, because we're a community, because why are we all sitting in this room? Because we're wanting to evolve. The idea of festivals, we all want to be together. We want to be one. We want a sense of community. I think if we do work at these big festivals, I think it's fantastic, but there needs to be a centering point that brings everyone together at the festival. Burning Man is unique in that it has 60,000 people around a whole man, and you're there for a purpose, to let go, release, whatever it is, to come together as a tribal entity. At Glastonbury and all these other festivals, it's all separated. So you need a sense of coming together, oneness, and no money. There's no money. This money thing is ridiculous.
But isn't money just a form of exchange, though,
exactly,
in the modern world?
Exactly.
There's nothing wrong. What part of the problem is that there's a poverty conscious amongst the alternative people. And I'd say that the main problem with the Big Green Gathering and Sunrise is that there is this poverty consciousness about, and the people that have got all the solutions, you know, it's us lot that have actually got the creativity to put the world in the right direction. But we're all so bloody skint, we're rubbing two ankles together and we can't get our shit together. And we're not prepared to pay for the things that we believe in.
But
like, well, hang on a minute. If we won't pay for the things we believe in, then we can't expect the mainstream to pay for it, you know, or to value it either. You know, if we're not going to value that which is the solution to the problems that we can see, we've got no hope.
We find the money for our drugs and our alcohol and our pretty clothes, right? But it is a way of thinking, as we expect the organisation to be our mother and our father and to take care of us. And, you know, it's definitely a shift of consciousness that has to happen, you know, in the whole community. And I'm as guilty of it as anybody else, of wanting something for nothing. It's just not the real world. You know, the real world is oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide, and money. It's the way it is, right? This is a discussion that I think needs to happen, and this is, I feel like we've barely scratched the surface here, because the festival movement to me is the building of a new world.
you know, and the organisms of the festival and the systems that we're learning how to create at the festival are the systems that will be the world that we live in maybe 20 years from now. So it's really important that we build on this, that we find a way forward through, you know, the system pushes back, it wants to extinguish this movement, and it's up to us to come together and take it forward, you know, to challenge these unnecessary rules and regulations that are coming down on us. But this part of the discussion has to end now, sadly, because I'd love to go on all night with this, because I feel like we've barely begun. And maybe next synergy or the synergy after, we can have a more substantial period of time and explore this further. But in the meantime, you know, let's just keep going for it. Each of us, you know, however we move, however piece of the jigsaw puzzle that we hold in this picture of our new world, let's find it within ourselves, bring it out, and put it on the table in context with each other. You know, stop criticizing each other, but just see the value that each of us is in this great tapestry that we're weaving of our new world. So thank you very much for tonight, and we'll continue, yeah? Did you want to say something quickly?
Just one thing. I just wanted to maybe suggest to all of us just to start being able to give more and not being able to, you know, think that we have to get something back. It would be so nice tonight in this wonderful, wonderful space if you didn't walk down there and know that you have to, like, buy something, you have to exchange money. Surely we should just start to see our circles. Let's just start to give and not know that we want to give something back. Just give of yourself. And the amazing thing is it manifests. It really does. We can live in a world where we're just going to be able to give back and forth. And we're not going to have to use this ridiculous currency.
Someone went to Burning Man.
Cool. Really, really, really quickly, anyone organising events or anyone who's having problems with licensing and paperwork getting in the way, write to people, tell them, get everyone to fucking make a fuss about it. Do you know what I mean? Like, get onto your MP, get onto the Department of Culture, Media and Sports, ask for feedback. Like, the least we can do, the bastards pretending to be democratic about it, is go along with them and humour them. Do you know what I mean? It's worth a try. Who knows? They might realise what they're actually crushing is a positive thing for everyone, you know, and it will become easier for us to put these events on.
Yeah, we will continue this. I think in February, something called Sacred Sites, Contested Rights. There's an author of a new book coming, and we'll continue.